I'll start from the top. Welcome to the broadcast. Thank you so much for being here tonight or watching in the future. And to skip over the boring stuff, what I was saying was that last weekend, I decided to take the night off on Saturday. And come Monday morning, I found myself probably more than anybody else missing the fact that I didn't preach and minister God's word and had that desire too. So as much as I'm on camera, I'm also doing this because I believe and speak and act on God's word, and it's nourishment for myself as well. So God bless you. Welcome. Thank you for being here. Please drop a comment on where you're watching from. And to everyone who's watching for the first time, my name is Evangelist Robert Keenan, and I'm here to edify you, to encourage you, to lift you up, to minister God's word, to pray for you, to strengthen you in the faith. If you say yes, but I don't feel like I have any faith, that's fine. You're in the right place, because the Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And in order for us to have our strength continually, our faith continually strengthened, we have but one thing to do. Continue to hear God's word. Continue to listen to, understand, believe, seek, study, and act on God's word. And that's when we see the fruit of our labor, the fruit of everything that we believe in and speak and act upon, which we know is God's holy and ordained word. Welcome, Brittany. Welcome, Exona. God bless you both. Welcome to everyone else who's watching in the future, everyone on YouTube. I love you. God bless you. And so we're going to talk about the battlefield of the mind tonight. Let's jump right into it. Please share the broadcast if you believe that God's word is important. The battlefield of the mind. Everything in our life starts with what's in our mind, right? If we conceive a thought, typically the speaking and the action of it comes next. Welcome, Dad. Thank you. God bless you too, Exona. And so the battlefield of the mind is more important than every other battle, because oftentimes that's where it stems from, right? And so if we address it when it comes in here, then addressing it outwardly is going to be much easier to solve and resolve. Welcome, Fernando, watching from California. God bless you, brother. Love you. And so the battlefield of the mind, I want to address depression. I want to address fear, anxiety, worry. I want to address destructive and toxic thoughts, destructive and toxic behaviors, and destructive and toxic ideologies. And so jumping right into it, we're going to talk all those things that I just mentioned essentially revolve around one thing, and it's called a stronghold. A stronghold, I'll give you the definition about it. So we're going to talk about strongholds tonight and what they are and how we're going to destroy them. Thank you, bro. Stronghold. A stronghold is a place where a particular cause or belief is strongly defended or upheld. Another definition says that a stronghold is a mindset, a value system, or a thought process that hinders your growth. Let me read that again. This is good. Welcome, Jenny Rose. Welcome, Clarice. A stronghold is a mindset, a value system up here, right? Or a thought process that hinders your growth. We don't want anything hindering our growth. We don't want anything hindering our growth in Christ. And so this is where we address it. We address strongholds. We address demonic forces and principalities and powers in the unseen realm. Because if the Bible says, I don't mean to get ahead of myself, but the Bible says that our warfare is not carnal, it's not flesh and blood, it's not a physical battle, but it's against the demonic powers, principalities, and authorities in the unseen realm. So we are warring against things that are not in front of our eyes. This is the most important war, and we're going to talk about how to win it tonight. And you know what? I see a bunch of victors I see a bunch of warriors tonight ready for God's word. Because the Bible says that we can be victorious, we can live in victory. And I'm looking at some victors and some warriors. Drop it in the comment. I will have the victory. Welcome, Matt. God bless you. So write that in the comments. I will have the victory. We just defined a stronghold, which I might define it a few more times tonight. A stronghold is a mindset. If you know you have some destructive mindsets, like I do, like we all do if you're human, then we have some stuff to address. Matt, you're very welcome. Please stay with us for the broadcast. This is super important stuff. So a stronghold, this mindset, this value system that stems from our mind or the thought processes that we have that could hinder our growth are what the Bible defines as a stronghold. The word strongholds is found once in the New Testament, used metaphorically by Paul in a description of the Christian's spiritual battle. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses or strongholds. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. This passage reveals the following facts about our warfare. And there are four facts about our warfare that are important to address regarding strongholds. Welcome, Nikki. God bless you and your husband and your family. I hope everyone's doing well tonight. And if you're not, you're actually in the right place. I've been praying for you, and I've been praying that this would reach people who need to hear it the most. I need to hear it just as much as anyone else. So the facts that are revealed about our warfare, number one, our battle is not planned according to the way that the world fights. Earthly stratagems are not our concern. So we're not talking about a physical fight. Number two, our weapons are not physical, for our warfare is spiritual in nature. Rather than guns and tanks, our weapons are those of the full armor of God and consist of the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 14 through 17. And so our weapons are not carnal, right? When we're in the battlefield of our mind, we are to address it with the full armor of God, which means that we have the truth. And Paul, the Apostle Paul, writes the full armor of God as it is physical armor. But we know that we're taking the truth of God's word, putting it around us like a belt. That we're putting on the breastplate of righteousness, our protection, right? In front of our hearts is the righteousness that God provides us. This is really good, don't miss it. Our feet are fitted or prepared with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. It means that we're ready to act swiftly according to God's word, hallelujah. And then we take up the shield of faith, right? Our faith in God is what protects us from the flaming arrows of Satan. Where is Satan shooting flaming arrows? I'll wait for the answer. Drop it in the comment. Where is Satan firing flaming arrows? What's the main place that he wants to get to before anything else? If Satan takes a shot at you, where's he going first? If Satan takes a shot at you, where is he going first? I know there's a delay. I was going to say it's possible that nobody's answering. Right. Exona said the mind. Nikki said your mind. Brittany said your mind. You're right. Your mind, Satan's coming first and foremost after your mind. Why? Because if he gets there first, everything else is taken care of. He can affect your your mind will affect your physical body. And if you give a foothold to fear, then it's like a wide open door to Satan. All he needs is a foothold. He's only coming after a small sliver of what you believe, and it goes into your mind. He will come after your mind first. You know, people closest to me know that I'll have struggles in my mind, right? Like we all do. I want to level with you, and I want to put myself at a place of vulnerability with you. Why? Because the Bible says that all believers face the same battles throughout the entire world. We go through the same things. And there's a heavy, heavy importance placed on what goes into our mind. The Bible says to, like I said, quoted earlier, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. The Bible says that the power of life and death is in the tongue, and those who love it will eat the consequences or eat the fruit of what they say, will have the consequences of what we say. In order to say something, we have to think it first. In my case, when I was a child, I got in trouble a lot for speaking before I thought. So I'll just leave that there. Number three, another fact about our warfare. Number three, our power comes from God alone. Our power comes from God alone. He gives us the Holy Spirit who lives on the inside of us, and he gives us an entire manuscript of accounts that God has had with mankind. And with this, we are armed with everything that we need to have victory in life. Can someone say amen? Say amen where you are out loud, or you can write in the comments. So our number three, our power comes from God alone. Hallelujah. Someone said to me in work, they said, oh, you're gonna need to say a prayer for this one. And I smiled. I said, that's all I'm gonna need. And he started laughing as well. Praise God. Number four, God's plan is to demolish spiritual strongholds. So the fourth fact about our warfare, we're talking about the battlefield of the mind tonight. The fourth fact of our warfare is that God's plan is to demolish spiritual strongholds. We said a stronghold earlier is a mindset, a value system, or a thought process that hinders your growth. And so that's God's plan, is to demolish it. What are these quote-unquote strongholds or fortifications we face? In the very next verse, Paul interprets the metaphor. We demolish arguments in every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:5. The quote-unquote arguments are the philosophies, reasonings, and schemes of the world. The pretensions have to do with anything proud, man-centered, and self-confident. I think that's pretty self-explanatory. I like what it says, though. The quote-unquote arguments, these are the arguments we face in our mind, right? Are the philosophies, reasonings, and schemes of the world. The quote-unquote pretensions have to do with anything proud, man-centered, and self-confident. You have to ask yourself, what's inspiring a thought? What's inspiring your speech, and what's inspiring an action? And I'll give you three things. Is the word of God inspiring your thought, your speech, or your action? Are you, or your human spirit, right, your flesh nature, and scratch that, because our spirit is joined with the spirit of Christ, and when we yield to him, the Holy Spirit is who works. So number one, is it the word of God or the spirit of God that's influencing our thoughts? Is it our sinful nature that's influencing our thoughts? Or is it Satan It looks like I froze. Can anyone please confirm? Can anyone please confirm that I'm still live or frozen? Okay, I got it. Never mind. Okay, so three things. God's influencing your mind, your thoughts. Your sinful nature is influencing your thoughts in your mind. Or is it Satan or his demons influencing your thoughts, right? And then our thoughts become our actions. I took a screenshot of this today, and I used to share it all the time, you know, when I was in the world, but it is true. Watch your thoughts. Thank you. Watch your thoughts, for they become your words. Watch your words, for they become your actions. Watch your actions, for they become habits. Watch your habits, for they become your character. Watch your character, for it becomes your destiny. So stemming from our mind is manifested through us, through our words, our actions, our habits, our character, into our destiny, right? So if we have the power to influence our destiny, this is not what the world teaches you. The world teaches you that destiny is just whatever happens to you. And whatever happens to someone might not be God's ordained plan for them. Tell me a five-year-old child who gets cancer, that was God's destiny for them. Not true. Jesus said, I have come. He said, the enemy, Satan, does not come but to steal, kill, and to destroy. I have come that you may have life and have it to the full, or have it everlasting, or have it in abundance. And if you take that as your belief, your theology, and just make it real childlike and say the devil is a bad devil and our God is a good God, you'll do just fine. If you take that as your belief and you run with it. Nikki said you froze. Okay, how am I doing now? Because I heard that I was frozen, then I was good. So any update would be great. And thank you so much for keeping me from total and utter embarrassment. You know, I don't typically freeze. In the audio, I've had it, you know what I mean, spotty once in a while. I just unplug it and it's fine. And plug it back in, of course. Thank you, honey. But Satan doesn't want this word going out. Why? Because the battlefield of our mind influences the rest of our life. Again, not going to get ahead of myself. I have one more paragraph to read out. I'll continue on with God's word. So here's the picture. The Christian, the believer, the follower of Christ, wearing his or her spiritual armor and bearing his or her spiritual weapons, sets out to conquer. Welcome, Catherine. God bless you. Tell Aaron I said hi and God bless him as well. So we set out to conquer, quote unquote, the world for Christ, but we soon find obstacles. The enemy has set up strongly fortified garrisons or barriers to resist the truth and thwart God's plan of redemption. Welcome, Max, aka Hillel. There is the fortress of human reasoning, reinforced with many subtle arguments and the pretense of logic. There's the castle of passion, with the flaming battlements defended by lust, pleasure, and greed. And there is the pinnacle of pride, in which the human heart sits enthroned and reveals in thoughts of its own excellence and sufficiency. So there's a few big words there. Listen to this last sentence. And there is the pinnacle of pride, in which the human heart sits enthroned and reveals in thoughts of its own excellence and sufficiency. The Bible says that by nature, our hearts are evil and desperately wicked. So that's why we don't go by our hearts. The world tells you, follow your heart, follow your heart. That is not good. That's not a good plan. The Bible says that we were born into sin. So if we're born with sinful nature or defective or deficient hearts and minds, we have to be renewed by the word of Christ. And then from his word, we can collect and understand and start to be divinely inspired by the wisdom and revelation and knowledge that comes from the Almighty God. And his wisdom is far above the wisdom of mankind. His knowledge is far above the smartest person in the world or the most highly defined or sought after philosophy by the world standards, because the highest philosophy or knowledge or revelation or wisdom is found in the Holy Bible. It speaks to every generation. The Bible says that the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing between the soul and spirit of a human being, the joints and the marrow. And it judges the thoughts and the intents of our hearts. So while we're reading this book is reading us. Hallelujah. So the battlefield of the mind, these strongholds, these thought processes that set themselves up in our mind by the world's ideologies, the world's knowledge, by demonic influences, need to be broken. And they need to be placed under the authority of Christ. The Bible says that we are to take every thought captive that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. We take those thoughts captive and we place them under the obedience of Christ. I know that I've had some crazy, wicked thoughts. I've had some things come out of nowhere and I'm like, that's ridiculous. That is not my thought. I reject it. If evil thoughts come after your mind, if they come into your mind and you, who's had that happen to them? I want this to be so practical that someone of any age could understand. Who has had evil and wicked thoughts come out of nowhere and that have caused or inspired depression, fear, anxiety, suicidal thoughts, malicious intent, anger, rage, right? Brittany said everyone, I'm sure, right? Everyone has, we have, and it happens to us. But what do we do with those things? We take them, we say, that's not my thought, and I place that thought under the obedience of Christ. And as a Christian, right? And so I'm getting wonderful feedback. Thank you. As a Christian, we still go through it. The people of the world, Satan pretty much leaves them alone, right? Unless they're not protected by Christ, so he can come and steal their life anytime. But Satan and his demons are after us, the church, the body of Christ, God's own sons and daughters. Why? Because we're the light of the world. Christ is manifested through his people, through your life. God wants to manifest his presence and his power, his anointing, his healing through you. He wants to use you as a vessel of honor to reach a lost and hurt and dying and broken world. And he desires to, and he will. What do we do? We first believe, then we speak, and then we act. The battlefield of the mind starts with our thoughts. So we are to take God's word. So we're talking about destroying strongholds. How do we do it? We first take God's word, we believe it. We take God's word, we speak it out of our mouth, deliberately. And then we act it out. Then we live according to what God's word says, and we see the fruit of our actions. We see the fruit of our belief and our speech. People put word curses on themselves all the time. And at the least, they bring themselves down by the way they speak. We have to remember to speak well, to edify one another, to bring each other up, to lift each other up. Welcome, Chris. Nice to have you. God bless you. And so we need to believe, speak, and act. We're talking about destroying strongholds tonight. Hallelujah. If you believe God's word, write in the comments, I believe. So if you go to Psalm 23, we don't have to go there right now, but there are all these things that God promises for you and provides for you, right? I'll read it. The Lord is my shepherd. Relationship. That's one. I shall not want. God supply. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. Rest. He leads me beside the still waters. Refreshment. He restores my soul. Healing. He leads me in the paths of righteousness. Guidance. For his namesake. Purpose. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Testing. I will fear no evil. Protection. For you are with me. Faithfulness. That's 10. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Discipline. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Hope. You anoint my head with oil. Consecration. My cup runs over. Abundance. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Blessing. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord. Security. Forever. Eternity. There are 17 things in Psalm 23 that God promises to provide for you. And you might say, oh, God provides us with testing, or God provides us with discipline. Yes, and any good father would. Any good heavenly father would provide his relationship, his supply, his rest, his healing, his guidance, his purpose, his protection, faithfulness, hope, consecration, abundance, blessing, security, and eternity for us, along with testing and discipline, because we need it. Welcome, Holden. God bless you. If you know that God's word is important tonight, please go ahead and share the broadcast. I want this to reach people who are in the battle or in the battlefield with their mind. And we're gonna teach and preach from God's word on how to destroy it. God bless you. Brittany said, I believe. Max said, God supply, I shall not want. Amen. Psalms 34:4. I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. Hallelujah. The psalmist writes that he sought the Lord, God heard him, and then God delivered him from all his fears. What do? We believe, we speak, and then we act. And our speech and our actions reflect on our belief. So when there's an ideology, when there's a thought process or a system set up in our mind, we have to actively believe, speak, and act against that, right? I'll tell you, you want me to share a stronghold in my mind that's been set up there since I was probably 12? A stronghold in my own mind that Satan has placed there, that other people have placed there, that I have reaffirmed, is that I'm fat. I've seen myself as fat, even though I've not been fat. Like, you know what I mean? So this isn't to shame any fat people. We're not fat shaming here. But I'm shaming the ideology that that's how I view myself. And I want to give you a real example, because people have these in their minds and it goes against their growth. It hinders their growth. They're just like we defined. There are beliefs inside our mind that hinder our growth. How? Our growth in our physical health, our growth in our mental health, our growth in our walk with God, our growth in our relationship with others, our growth in our progress in our career, our growth and progress in every area of life. If you believe that you're still a kid, you'll never mature. If you believe this stuff, if you believe whatever Satan has tried to set up in your mind and you speak on it and act it, it will become part of your life. And this is not God's plan for you. God's plan is to restore you, to heal you, to strengthen you, to bless you, to lift you up, to guard you, to protect you, to use you as the light of the world to others. Hallelujah. Our power comes from God alone, and God's plan is to demolish spiritual strongholds. Spiritual strongholds, my friends, are in our mind. And that's where Satan comes first. He wants to set up in our mind. What do we do to fight against it? We believe God's word, we speak it, and we act it out. So, in the face of this stronghold that's been set up in my mind, I've acted on it by controlling what I eat, by going to the gym, by speaking well about myself in a way that glorifies God. Hallelujah. Where we left off was Psalms 34:4. When David said, I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. If you have fears and you seek the Lord, he hears you and desires to deliver you. This is one of my favorite verses. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. The Bible commands us, even though it's difficult at times, the Bible says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Praise God. So if you find yourself anxious over something or worrying about something, the Bible says that what we're supposed to do with it is to give it to God, thank him for every good thing, and then what happens from there? We are to expect to have his divine peace of heart and mind. Max says, when someone prays over me, I will say with my words, I receive it and believe what you have said, hallelujah. Then I have chosen, I can't see it, it cuts off. Exodus said, so true, our mind can definitely either hinder us in our walk or help us go forward when we overcome these battles, and then it's cut off again. So I agree. So in these things that are strongholds in our mind that we might feed into, right, and cause us to be anxious or fearful or worry, the word of God says, no, don't do that. Don't even worry about it. Don't consider it. Just give it to God, thank him for everything, and expect that this divine peace that he provides will guard your hearts and minds. Can you say amen? What a wonderful promise. So I copied and pasted or wrote throughout this entire preparation, believe, speak, and act. So Philippians 4, 6, and 7, when the Bible says, don't be anxious for anything, right? And I just read it, I won't go through it again. But if we don't take it and act on it, we think that prayer is simply a coping mechanism. Prayer is not a coping mechanism to just get pushed around by whatever happens to us in our life. Prayer is asking God to come into the earth realm and change things that we couldn't change on our own. And I've seen it written a little bit better than that. But the idea is that we don't just pray and feel better. That's not it. We pray, Jesus said to pray with relentless persistence. Shameless persistence. Jesus said, pray with shameless persistence. Why? Because it's God's will that prayer changes things. Prayer changes where we are in our schooling, in our career, in geographically, where we are in relationships, where we are in habits, right? We're supposed to pray without ceasing. Wherever and whatever is not going right in your life, talk to God. The prayer is not a chore, and prayer is not a coping mechanism. You're having a conversation with the Almighty God, who will move on your behalf and desires to show himself strong on your behalf. Welcome, Paulo. God bless you. God bless your wife and your new baby. And so the battlefield of the mind is where everything starts. And if we start to believe whatever Satan sends us, then we've bought and we've already started the losing process. However, if we'll speak and act against it deliberately in cooperation with God's word, we'll have the victory. Someone write that in the comments. I will have the victory. Hallelujah. The devil might come to you and say, I want to drink alcohol, right? Because if you heard a voice in your head or a thought that said you want to drink alcohol, you'd be like, no, I don't, right? If you don't want to. But these thoughts come as first person thoughts. Be weary, be on guard against these first person thoughts that try to influence, in effect, your thoughts as though they are your own, if they're not your own, right? Hallelujah. That's right. Max said, I will be victorious in Christ. That's where we get our victory. So if we don't believe it, we'll never speak it. And if we never speak it, we will most likely never act on it. Believe, speak, and act. Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. John 14:27. Something comes terrifying, or something comes tempting, or something comes depressing, or something comes binding, like it wants to hold you where you are. If these types of things come to your mind, you have to take God's word. Because Jesus said, let not, or don't let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And you can say, I won't be afraid. A proud thought gets you to try to cause trouble in your family, with siblings, in the workplace, at home, wherever it is, in church, even amongst believers. You want to say, I'm not going to be prideful. The Bible says that we're supposed to consider others above ourselves, right? And if we consider people above ourselves, then we can't get proud. If a thought comes that I'm getting sick, I don't feel well, I'm getting sick, I don't feel well, and then we start to speak it, our body starts to cooperate. Why? Because the power of life and death is in the tongue. And so we need to take these thoughts before they become strongholds and destroy them and speak against them. I will be healthy. My body will function in godly perfection. I'm getting better. I'm getting stronger. And then at the same time, you're taking vitamins. You're drinking plenty of water. You're resting. You're exercising. You're doing all these other things in the natural to combat it. But it starts in your mind. It starts what you believe and speak, my friends. Please. This affects every other part of our life. If you have a good example, think of a good example and drop it in the comments. What is something that comes into your mind that can try to negatively affect you? And we can talk about combating these things. Before I was serving Christ, I would think very hopelessly at times, not all the time. In fact, most of the time I was the opposite. But it's natural that hopelessness tries coming after us from time to time. And if we allow hopelessness to set up space in our mind for free, then it will end up costing us dividends because we start speaking it and putting it out there. I don't know what to do. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know how this is going to happen. I don't know how I'm going to pay for this. I don't know how I'm going to make the bills. I don't know how. And you're in a perpetual state of not knowing. You know, that those are some words that I don't speak on a daily basis. I don't say I don't know. I either say I'm going to find out, I couldn't tell you. I'm just not placing myself in that self-think of I don't know. And plus, on top of it, it doesn't add confidence to the people who are listening to you, right? 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." Hallelujah. That's something I want you to commit to memory. For God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. For as long as I can remember, I've always had thoughts that I wasn't good enough and can never achieve what I set my mind. Let me see if I can select see more from without messing it up. I'm finally overcoming these thoughts because of Jesus, and I was able to do what God has called me to do. Amen. Sister, that's very good. There are these thoughts that come after us. Like I said, I thought like there was a stronghold that's been with me for years that I think of myself as fat, even though I'm not fat. I might be a few pounds overweight. That's because I love cheesecake, right? No, but these thoughts, and I'm using something, you know, somewhat harmless, as long as I don't actually live like that, confess it and believe it and just say, I'm gonna be fat forever, I'm gonna, you know what I mean, and allow that to run my life. There are much more dangerous things that come after our minds, and I'm here for you, I'm here for those who are gonna hear in the future, and I'm here for those who aren't hearing this, but I pray that God's word will reach them, and I'm relying on us collectively to get it to them. So there are much more dangerous things, like our sister shared about how we think we're not good enough, or we think that, yes, I can't accomplish something because of whatever, or I'm always going to be broke, right? People say, I'm broke, I can't pay the bills, I have no money, and they just perpetually speak like that. Instead of believing that there's a way out, speaking about it, and then acting on it, starting to cut down on their spending, budgeting, find out about ways of investing, cut their credit card. I mean, there's a million different things that can contribute to financial prosperity in your life. And this goes along with everything else. But if we can talk about what it is that afflicts our mind and learn how to address it, we're pretty much setting ourselves up for the foundation of success in everything else. Can someone say amen? Amen. I didn't plan on saying my own amen. But let me say that again. So there are things, there are thoughts, there are ideologies, thought systems that set themselves up in our mind that if we can learn how to address them and to destroy them, dismantle them, and place them under the obedience of the word of Christ, then we will have laid the foundation of success in every area of our life. If we're talking about relationships, many a times it's forgiveness. If you haven't forgiven someone, there's a mindset in your head that says, screw that person, they've hurt me, they've burned me, they stole money from me, they cheated on me, they abused me, they called me this, they publicly embarrassed me. Whatever it is that someone might have done to you to hurt you, and you've held on to the unforgiveness, that unforgiveness has manifested in your mind a stronghold. Am I talking to someone today? So if we take these strongholds and start to address them, how would we address it? Father God, I forgive them for hurting me. I forgive that person for stealing thousands of dollars from me. And I'm talking from my own experience on that one. I forgive that person for hurting me, for breaking my heart, for whatever it is. And you take something that you've held on to and said, screw that person, I don't care if they die, whatever, whatever. Don't let it contribute to being a stronghold. Say, Father God, I forgive that person. And if you feel the opposite way the next morning, forgive that person. Father God, I forgive that person. I turn over John Smith to you, right? Whoever put someone's name in there. Father God, I give you the person who has hurt my brother, hurt my sister, right? And you know what it is. You know what these things are. But if you forgive them, you start to let go. You start to dismantle that stronghold in your mind. if you call someone who hurt you and offended you and say, hey, listen, I just want to talk to you for a minute. I want to forgive you for hurting me. Maybe they don't know what's coming. Hey, you said this to me in 2019 and I want to forgive you for it. It's been on my mind. It's why I haven't called you. Can you please, I want to forgive you for it, right? If you're holding on to it. Or if you've hurt someone else and you know it's time to seek forgiveness from them, you call them, listen, I know it's been a while. I want you to please forgive me for doing this. Please forgive me. This is about you. This is about you and God. This is not about you and the other person anymore. Hallelujah. And if you deal with forgiving someone and seeking forgiveness from someone else, this is where healing starts. This is where weights lift off of your shoulder. This is where prayers start to become answered. Why? Because Jesus said, if you don't forgive those who have sinned against you, my Father in heaven won't forgive you. And so this is actually a key to answered prayer that I think isn't taught on enough of the time. The Bible says to pray in faith. The Bible says to pray believing that you'll receive it and even confessing it. Mark 11, 22 and 23. That's where that it says that. Matthew 6, 14, Jesus said, if you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. And there's other places in the Bible that attributes unforgiveness to unanswered sins. Unanswered prayers. So if you pray and don't receive, your unforgiveness could be holding up your harvest. I wish I could say that again. You can go back and listen to it again. If you don't forgive someone, then chances are your unforgiveness will hold up your harvest. Okay, I didn't say that word for word. You get the point. When God spoke to Joshua, this is what he said, and I want you, as a practice, to put your name in front of it. So if I'm speaking, I would say, Robert, be strong and courageous. So when you hear these words, you put your name in front of it, and this is what God would have to say to you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book. What's this book? This book. And meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command to you. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. If the Lord your God is with you wherever you go, and I'm talking to myself at the same time, how do we allow strongholds to be set up in our mind if the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us? When you have these negative thoughts, you want to say, I have the mind of Christ. I reject that. That's not for me. I reject these thoughts in Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit has sealed you for the day of redemption, the Bible says. And so God's encouragement to you is to be strong and courageous, to meditate on God's word, to not deviate from the book of instruction. Meditate on it day and night, right? And then you will prosper and succeed in all you do. That's his will for you, that you prosper and succeed in all you do. Hallelujah. So these mindsets, these thought processes, these systems that try to go up in our minds, these value systems, we tear them down by God's word and we say, I will prosper and succeed in all I do because that's God's will for me. My dad says, I believe there's a connection between forgiveness and healing. Amen. 100%. I've seen sermons on it as well. When people forgive one another, they're healed mentally and physically. And certainly emotionally. So these commands from God's word is for you to be strong and courageous. It's for you to not be afraid or discouraged. Why? Because the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Hallelujah. If you have experienced the love of God through Jesus Christ, the Bible says that there is no fear in love. But perfect love casts out all fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. Someone said, the only thing to fear is fear itself. Wrong. The only thing to fear is God. Why? He's the Almighty. He is the one we stand before on Judgment Day. He is the one who created us and dictates what our lives should be. So just remember that there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because why? Because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. If you find yourself with a stronghold of fear, you speak against it. You believe that God's word is not for you. His will is not for you to fear. And then you speak against it and you act against it. Good example. Very non-threatening example, but if you can make the connection to the other things in your life, you'll do just well. If you're afraid to talk to people, you have a fear of talking to people. You can only do well by talking to other people, right? And so this, like I said, is very surface level, but I'm hoping that you would take that concept and use it and strategize on acting against it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you want to be made perfect in love, that love comes from God through Jesus Christ by being born again. This is the whole finale. This is the whole thing. This is why I'm here. This is why I'm on the earth. If I could encourage you, urge you, move you towards doing one thing, it would be to repent of sin, give your life to God, give your whole life to God, and ask him to forgive you of sin, make you new. And the Bible gives us the promise of you being born again, that you can have a completely new life, that reset button actually exists by relationship with God. Jesus said, most assuredly, not assuredly, which is, I'm very sure, I'm 100% sure, most assuredly, I've never been more sure of anything in my life. Jesus said, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. We must be baptized. We must be born again. How are we born again? By the Holy Spirit. That starts with our belief in God, our confession of Christ, and our repentance of sin. From that confession, from the time the confession is made, you go and get water baptized as a public confession to say, I'm following Christ with my life. And the Bible says the old person, the old you, dies in the water and you're raised to new life with Jesus Christ. So if that's you, you're watching this in the future, I don't care. That God doesn't care when you're seeing this or what you've done in your life or what has happened, taken place. None of it is bigger than the salvation that he provides. So I want to invite you, friend, to pray with me now. And people say, oh, you can't just have salvation from a prayer and Jesus come into my heart. I've seen people delivered from oppression, from possession by Satan because of the confession of Jesus Christ. And what you do from there is up to you. The Bible says to live out your salvation with fear and trembling. So if that's you and you want to make that decision for Jesus Christ tonight, I'm going to invite you to pray. A prayer of repentance, a prayer of asking God for forgiveness, and asking that he would come into your life make you new and change you and give you the power to live for him. So wherever you are, I want you to bow your head in reverence before a holy and perfect God. I want you to close your eyes so you're not distracted by anything around you. And I want you to repeat these words from your own mouth, but from your heart as well. And say them from your heart, knowing that this is between you and God, not between you and me. Say these words: Father God, I know I've sinned, and I want you to forgive me of sin. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son, and that he died for me on the cross to save me from sin and hell. I thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. I pray that you would be my Lord and my Savior and forgive me for every wrong I've done. God, give me the power to live for you. Please fill me with the Holy Spirit. And I thank you for your forgiveness. And I give you my life. I will live for you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And if you've said that prayer, God bless you. Welcome to the family of God. Welcome, Rich and Bridget. Perfect timing, right at the very last minute. You want to go back and listen to the entire hour of the battlefield of the mind. We talked about what a stronghold is, how to destroy it, and the fact that we all, including myself, will go through things in life that try to set up in our minds and that do set themselves up, and we have to dismantle these thoughts. We have to dismantle these value systems, these thought processes that are completely destructive. We take God's word, we take the authority of what Jesus said, and we take these thoughts and say, those aren't my thoughts, and we place them under the obedience of Christ. And you'll do very well to partner with God in destroying and dismantling the strongholds that have been set up in your life. No matter what it is, I gave examples, personal examples of what I have been through, right? And maybe it was very surface level, but this goes a lot for different people on many different subjects and topics. Max said, don't let lies have a sleepover with you. Right. You know, you can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from making a nest in your hair. Did you hear that? You can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from making a nest in your hair. This is like the devil. You can't stop the thoughts that will come to you, but you can stop them from setting up permanent thought processes and value systems in your mind in the name of Jesus Christ and in the authority that God's word gives to you in the power of Christ in you. I want to encourage you, please go ahead and share this broadcast so it can reach people who is in the battlefield of their own mind. I believe it has the power to change people's lives like it did for me, like it did for you. If you want to drop a comment below, we'll be ending within the minute. Welcome, Cookie. God bless you. Nice to see you. Although we are done. So if you want to drop a comment below, I want to say good night. I want to say God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us. And I hope that God's word found you very well, that there's progress in your life, that there's God's power in your life, that his word reigns supreme in your mind every day in the name of Jesus Christ. Let me pray for you. All you have to do is believe it and receive it on your end and confess it. Let's pray. Father God, I pray that you would bless everyone who's listening right now and in the future. I pray that you would touch their hearts and minds, that you would change them by the power of your word. I pray that strongholds and mindsets would be cast down in the name of Jesus Christ, that you would help break them down by your word, that you would forgive us of trespasses against you. We pray that you would forgive us of holding on to unforgiveness against other people, and we turn over those people to you. God, we thank you for every good thing in our lives. We thank you for your word. We thank you for family and friends. We thank you for protection, roofs over our heads, for food and water, and for every breath that we take. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for working in our lives and in our hearts and minds. I pray for peace for everyone who's listening now and in the future. God, give them peace. Give them the peace that surpasses all understanding. Give them strength in their bodies, in their minds, in their hearts. Give them the strength that you provide. And let it be all to the glory of Jesus Christ. And we ask together in the name of Jesus and in the authority of Jesus. And we say amen. Drop an amen in the comments. Say an amen where you are out loud. And I pray that 2023 is the best year that you've ever had. I believe there are two more Saturdays that we'll have together. It's December 17th. So we'll have Christmas Eve if I do preach. And the 31st, I will be at a wedding. So I might not see you till next year. So in closing, I want to say thank you so much for being on tonight. I hope you're blessed. I hope you prosper in everything that you do, that you believe, speak, and act according to God's word. And if you do, and when you do, you'll see the fruit and you'll see the harvest of your investment and belief in God's word. I love you very much. My name is Evangelist Robert Keenan. I'll see you on the next one. God bless you.